2007, there was a salary plan from a committee made up of county employees and elected officials. I didn't serve on that committee. I didn't drive the process. I didn't ask for anything. The committee came out with a salary plan. It affected every position in county government, including the county judge, the commissioners, every elected position, and all the way throughout the county, road and bridge, sheriff's department, other positions. We voted for it. We put it in place. I answered the question then. I determined later that that was a mistake. I shouldn't have accepted that raise my first year in office. I've answered this question 1,000 times before. It's been played out in the media 1,000 times. I take full responsibility for my action. It was wrong. I shouldn't have done it. I corrected it by waiving the rest of the salary that was called for in that salary plan, and I promised at that time, if I was reelected, I would accept the salary. And that's the only time I accept the salary. It's budgeted. It was budgeted salary. I accepted the salary after running for re-election in 2009 and not having an opponent. So I accepted that salary that was set out in the budget in 2010. So it's slightly mischaracterized. But I'm not going to let those actions define the success of the last 7 years. I'm sorry, the $4 million? The $4 million that was cut from the road and bridge budget, it was necessary. As I said before, there was a spike in the road and bridge budget. So, you know, and I can't go back and remember what the 2005 and 2006 budgets were, but they were substantially less than 2007, 2008, 2009. In 2010, we had to cut money. We had to, because at that point, we were being told that we were going to have a 4-cent tax increase just to cover the needs in Smith County. So we made that reduction of $4 million. We did not cut 33 employees from Smith County. We cut 33 positions from Smith County, and there's a large difference. There were positions that were not filled. The majority of those positions were not filled. There were some people that lost their jobs, clearly, and that's a sad, unfortunate thing. But I'll tell you, I stand by the decision we made then because it was important to the entire community, and we needed to make those changes. I don't want to grow the road and bridge employee base now. I think what we did was important. We made it more efficient, and I think going forward, that's what we're going to do. We're going to keep it efficient. We're going to keep the numbers of employees in that department low, and we're going to bid out the major projects to private sector businesses.
Okay. Mr. Furlow, regarding your question, you have a comment?
Yes. One thing Judge Baker neglects to tell you, in that study on the salary plan, it was done by the Commissioner's Court. Then he and the county auditor went back and added the elected officials. The initial salary indication and assessment was primarily for the county employees to put them on a graduated improvement, create career paths, and he and the county auditor went back and added the elected officials. That's where his pay raise came from. In true aspect of leadership, you should never take any pay raise while you're laying anybody off or you're tightening your belt. That's one of the problems that we have with American business now. There's the lack of leadership. I'll show you leadership if I'm elected, because I'm going to cut my salary of the county judge back to what it was prior to the current occupant giving himself that raise.
Okay. We're going to try to keep on. Quick response.
The fact is, I was not on a committee, and I didn't make a decision. I didn't ask the auditor to have that. The Commissioner's Court was not part of the committee. Two members of the court were on the committee. I was not. But when we talk about leadership, and I get criticized for salary increases, Mr. Furlow continues to neglect to mention the fact that he accepted two paychecks as serving for the state Texas National Guard. He fails to mention that. He says that my taking a raise of $10,000 and later taking the budgeted salary, which was $12,000 higher, it is somehow a lack of leadership. And no doubt, some people may believe it is. But I would suggest to you that taking two salaries to the tune of an overpayment of $130,000 also shows a lack of leadership when he and four other generals in the Texas National Guard were the only people that were able to do that or to get away with that, when all the other people who were serving in various capacities in the Texas National Guard were not able to do the same thing.
Yeah, let me make a quick assessment on that. It was not two paychecks. I'm involved in that lawsuit. In the way the military pay is structured in the National Guard under U.S. Title 32, you have to change statuses from a state status to a federal status. There was more than five. There were 6,500 individuals in Texas on a monthly basis get two paychecks. All my documents are on the pay. In the process, I received no due process. I received no ability. The $130,000 I'm being charged with, I don't have any idea where it come from. And if you would think that I had done something wrong, the Attorney General would have hung me up by my heels a whole lot long ago. And they're what they're pushing. And I finally got a court date the other day on the 16th of June, and I'm going to invite Judge Baker to attend. But in that aspect of the life that I've had to live is a full disclosure of everything that I've done. Now I think it's time to bring out something that he has failed to disclose in his leadership. He has a police record. He is a public official. While he was in a rent property, videotaping his neighbor, and never disclosed it.
We need a closing comment. You can say more. We understand the problem.
I think it's only fair that
we will allow. We'll allow. Judge Baker, I said it wrong. We're going to allow you guys to discuss
it. But he made an allegation of something that needs to be responded to. And that's only fair.
Let's talk this out now.
One response and one response to Mr. Furlow.
What you just heard from my opponent was a complete lie and a fabrication, and he knows it. I was never accused of videotaping my neighbor. Never. Never. And if you read the police report, that's what it says. So read the report. I invite you to. This is all out in public record. Do you not think that this would have been on the news had that happened? I mean, this has played out over the last, this is something that allegedly occurred 2.5 years ago. An allegation was made, it was proved to be false, and it's disingenuous for my opponent to play dirty political tricks.
Now, let me say this. My opponent's innocent, presumed guilty. The point of it is when he brings up my Austin situation, as a public official, he is obligated by law, and he should have learned that in his lawyer training as head of the state bar and from the ethics commission from the state. He needed to disclose that. He owed himself that to ensure he cleared his name and his reputation. He elected not to do that, and that brings suspicion on him of who he is and goes back to leadership. But I want you to know, for me, the report exists. There's no investigation, just like with me. There was no due process for him, just like for me. But he was allowed to cover it up, and I have been standing in the breach, standing up to the government and the governor of this state of Texas, and that's all I'm asking you. He should have disclosed it. Now, the aspect of it is, what else is he not disclosing to you?
Since we somehow, gentlemen, got off the topic of roads and funding roads, let's go right back to that. Mr. Furlow, you support county tax money being spent on state highway or toll projects, such as Loop 49. Why or why not?
The answer is real simple. No. And I'm going to tell you why. The state has $21 billion of infrastructure debt right now and is in a cutback from the federal dollars and the state dollars as we move forward to the future. Is there's going to be more and more aspect of people that try to get a hold of local people to pay with their tax money bills that they did not create. The state is responsible for it. I heard this the other day. The state is sitting around figuring out how they're going to spend a 28% surplus in the next session. They ought to be paying some of their debt off and not asking some of the local people to pick it up. There's responsibility at the state level and the state elected officials that they need to do what they've been elected to do and provide the state infrastructure, and that's not being done right now. So I'm totally against it.
Can you ask the question again? I heard you say it.
Do you support county tax money being spent on state highway or toll projects such as Loop 49? Why or why not?
Only when it's required by law. Because one fact that people fail to understand is that the county is obligated by statute to pay a portion of the right-of-way acquisition costs for state highways. That includes all the FM roads, any state highways, interstates, and other things. It's debatable on whether the county should participate in special financing options that are given to them by the state, such as the most recent thing that you've heard about in the news, which is the TRZ, Tax Reinvestment Zones, that are authorized by state law. It was given to be a tool by the state legislature, frankly, because the state doesn't want the obligation anymore. The state is pushing more burdens onto county government. They do that all the time. You hear the buzz phrase, unfunded mandates. Well, the fact is, they don't have money, so they're going to push it down somebody who they think can afford it. They don't want to raise taxes because they think they can. So it's always a problem. It's always a battle back and forth. Every legislative session, we work on these things to try to push back and say, no, maintain your obligation. We don't want it. But the fact is, there's the money's drying up. The state's not going to do some of the projects that they should be obligated to do. So the county has recently looked at this TRC proposal. And what it is you take a corridor that is considered to be underdeveloped and could use some funding mechanism to improve it. You take, for instance, in our proposal, it was to take a 2-mile corridor all along the proposed route and current route of Loop 49, and to capture the baseline value of the property in that area for this year or for whatever year you choose. And as things naturally grow in value because of development and because of just improvement to those properties, we would capture a portion of that and devote it totally to a project within that corridor, such as finishing the Lindell Relief Route, such as adding service roads in certain areas. It's just an option. It's something we're looking at. We're still considering it. We didn't like it in the initial form, so we're looking at it. We're studying it. You know, we got a lot of people in this community who thought that would be a great funding mechanism for us. But it does not come without criticism as well, just as anything we do in the county government. So it's something we're interested in, exploring, making sure we completely understand it. Unlike Obamacare, we're not going to vote for it before we read it. So we're going to work on it.
Okay. I'm allowing to be a quick rebuttal should you choose on that, but we're going to try to stay on top.
The judge is absolutely right. If it's mandated by state, and if there is a mandate to take away local taxpayers' money and use it on state projects, I'm totally against that. The fact of it is, this TRZ was turned away from by the city of Tyler. City of Tyler is a model city in this area. In fact, they have a way ahead plan. They have a strategic plan. And they walked away from their involvement in this over a year ago. And that ought to mean something in asking them why they didn't like what it had. And hooking up with the aldermen and the councilmen of the city of Tyler, just asking why they didn't like it, because to a person, they didn't.